Today, amongst other things, I'll explain to you what's happening right before the highly anticipated SpaceX Starship Serial Number 8 flight, what's to come after it, and how three absolutely stunning scientific probes are bringing space down to Earth.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch. Let's light this candle.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix, and I am your host for today's episode of What About It? And as always, there has been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. Starship updates. Hello, person from the future! So, how'd it go? Did Starship Serial Number 8 take off? Did it land again? That's what I'd like to ask you right now. But unfortunately, I am stuck here in the past, and so far the SpaceX launch did not take place yet. But here's the good thing. SpaceX is not just working on one task. Besides Starship Serial Number 8, SpaceX has a full pile of objectives and milestones to meet. This is a drive-by made by someone we normally just know from high up in the air. Mauricio from RGB Aerial Photography took the car and made a video on the ground due to thick cloud coverage on site. This is Highway 4, the road right next to SpaceX's Starship facility. He's driving away from the beach, and on the left side we can see the launch site. Orbital launch mount, landing pad, Starhopper and Starship Serial Number 8 on test pad A, waiting for the big day. A flight originally was expected for Wednesday of last week. Then it was Friday, then Sunday, and as of recording the episode, it's supposed to be today. Of course, the whole Y team is crossing fingers, most likely as much as you are too. So far, everything is looking good. Then on Tuesday, we had the first glimpse at what we can expect for the launch, and let me tell you, if you missed the party, go rewatch parts of it on the channel after this episode. Almost 1 million people watched with us over the course of more than 10 hours of live streaming. The excitement and the emotions were busting the scale. Thank you to all who made this day truly unforgettable. Thank you to all the new subscribers, members, supporters. I am honestly still stoked about it, but let's cut to the chase here. It was a scrub. Everything was going down towards the launch. SpaceX was committed. NASA sent a tracking plane down from Houston. The flaps got cut loose and were tested. The Starship was preparing for launch. Fueling happened. A huge shout out to Lab Padre for giving us the opportunity to watch his stream. Go check out his channel, give him a like and subscribe right now. He and his whole team deserve it so much. Then SpaceX's stream went live, and oh boy, what a sight it was. Seeing Starship Serial Number 8 on the pad alive and breathing was an amazing sight to behold. What SpaceX is doing here is inspiring the whole world, and it is such a rewarding feeling to know that we are playing a small part in spreading the word here at What About It. And the countdown clock went down towards T-0. Let's listen in here on the last final seconds.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1, Raptor abort.
And that was it. We had a last second Raptor abort. The turbopump spun up, but there was no ignition. As I said around 1,000 times on the live stream though during the 10 hours, this is to be expected when testing prototypes. There is no official word as to what caused the problem as of recording this, and I will make sure to update all of you ASAP as soon as there is. SpaceX will most definitely go for another try as soon as they have fixed the issue, and you do not want to miss this. Make sure to follow me on Twitter for frequent updates on how we're going to proceed from here on. We are closing in on something historical here. New test dates have already been set, and they give a first indicator as to when to expect another try on taking the first Starship prototype up to a height of 12.5 kilometers. We have dates ranging from today, December 9th, all the way to December 11th right now. So do not go on holiday. Tell your friends to join you for the next Y livestream and prepare for another 10-hour marathon stream with the best community there is in the world. Thank you, Team Space, for giving us all the honor. Do not be upset or lose hope, or in the worst case, even be disappointed about SpaceX. This is prototyping. It's a fluent process. Dates shift as results are very unpredictable. It's hard to tell when, but one thing is for sure, it will happen. And SpaceX is not slowing down either. As much as it might feel like the Starship development is at a halt right now to those who are just looking for that next flight day, quite the opposite is the case in Boca Chica. SpaceX is preparing something big. Mary from NASAspaceflight.com was able to film a monster passing by. The new roll lift, likely intended to carry Starship Serial Number 9 down to the launch site. Fully assembled starships are getting too heavy for one or maybe two roll lifts. It takes four of them. And this is what it will be needed for. Starship Serial Number 9 sitting in the SpaceX high bay at the construction site and ready for rollout. This basically is the perfect scenario. One starship waiting for ignition at the launch site and another one improved and more capable already just waiting to be transported to the pad. Even though everything seems to be in a waiting position right now, the opposite is the case. Jack Beyer, jack of all trades and former editor for Team Y, took two very nice pictures of Starship Serial Number 8 and 9 from as similar of an angle as possible for comparison. So let's do just that. Let's compare the two starship generations side by side. Top to bottom, let's go. At a first glance, one could think that there's not much of a difference at all. But looking closer, the two are quite different already. Things that seem like not much of a change at first tell a different story once properly analyzed. These three weld marks, for example. On Starship Serial Number 8, it's one, and on Serial Number 9, there are three. These weld marks, in general, are a sign for SpaceX workers attaching equipment and system components on the inside of the hull. Either there is a different setup on the inside, or it has been attached better. On we go with the weld between nose cone and fairing skirt. Clearly a much smoother construction on Serial Number 9 due to the fact that Serial Number 8 was stacked at the launch site, while Serial Number 9 enjoyed the comforts of the high bay for this task, resulting in a much better nose cone seal. Hatches are in different places. This could either be due to the fact that internal setups are different or that structural integrity is better if the hatches are in a different place. Aerodynamic covers seem to be slightly different with access holes towards the actuators and hinges in different places. One thing though that's hard to spot might be the most important change. Ring segments need to be welded together to form the ring. This weld line poses a challenge for the engineers as it changes the property of the hull in that spot. Where on Starship Serial Number 8 these welds are all over the place on the fairing section, they form one uniform line on the hull of Serial Number 9 from top to bottom. Looking at all the changes together, we can see that an at first very similar starship in fact is full of changes all over the outside. And if there are so many changes on the outside, there are very likely many more on the inside. Thank you, Jack, for giving us the opportunity to do this. And Serial Number 9 is just the tip of the iceberg. Once Starship Serial Number 8 has performed its flight, things are likely to speed up even further. Two starship hops and one flight in 2020. How many will we see in 2021? Give me your estimate under the pinned comment right under this video. The Y team needs your support. Give the video a like, subscribe and share it to show the YouTube algorithm that you appreciate the content. Want to give a more direct support? Consider becoming a patron or a YouTube member and get awesome perks like access to our Discord server where I discuss space topics with the community every day. Do you know about the Y warehouse? Shop for your next Starship shirt or grab our famous Raptor blueprint shirt and countless other shirts made by space nerds for other space nerds. Links can be found in the description. You rock! And progress is being made on all fronts. Here's a shot from the latest flyby done by Mauricio from RGB Aerial Photography. It shows a circular object laying on the ground right next to the old Mark 1 nose cone. And this could very well be early concept work or even an actual thrust pack for a super heavy booster. A while back, Elon Musk gave an update on how the Super Heavy boosters will control their flight with 8 center engines equipped with thrust vector control. Casper Stanley, with some help from the jettisoned guy, made an absolutely awesome animation showing how thrust vector control works. In this case, on Starship Serial Number 8, you can see that the thrusters are actuated by pistons displayed in yellow, and then the engines are attached to the thrust pack via a gimbal joint which can move in any direction and up to 15 degrees. There are 8 holes arranged in a circle. Now, I'm not completely sure if this really is a thrust pack or even final hardware, but it gives a good indication for how far along SpaceX is with that first Super Heavy booster. SpaceX is working on Starship Serial Number 15 and 16 by now. That's 7 more starships in the work, with Serial Number 9 almost ready for some flight action. The pace at which SpaceX is moving is astonishing. Do not be distracted by delays with the Serial Number 8 flight. And while we're watching new starships being built, old ones have to vanish. This is Starship Mark 1's nose cone that's been sitting next to the small bay for over a year now. SpaceX has decided that it is time for it to move. It's still unclear if it will be completely disassembled. If I could, I would vote for a spot in a museum, but it's up to SpaceX. Farewell, Mark 1. You were a beacon of hope and an indicator of a new age. Save Mark 1, Elon! This is SpaceX, moving fast and showing us the future today. Samples incoming. Next up, I want to talk about three incredible missions that are all about bringing space down to Earth for everyday scientists, so to speak. What you're looking at here are three rockets lifting off from planet Earth. Hayabusa 2 in 2014, OSIRIS-REx in 2016, and Chang'e 5. Maybe Molly can help me with that.
Hello!
The way you correctly pronounce that word is Chang'e. Chang'e is an important person in Chinese mythological legends. Basically, she's this like normal person on Earth, and then she just sacrificed herself to protect her husband. So she now got transported to the moon of immortality, and that is where she lives, except she comes back for Chinese Valentine's Day, and then she's gone again. And then we eat mooncakes to honor her. Yay, bye!
All three had a similar goal. Pick up samples from an extraterrestrial body and return them back home. Hayabusa 2, an asteroid sample return mission, had the longest distance to travel. 6 years in the making, and with a very impressive asteroid chase, it had to do a race with its target using a gravity assist from Earth and ion thrusters propulsion to get to its target. Finally, on February 22nd of 2019, it finished the task. It poked the asteroid Ryugu and successfully scooped up a sample in the process. A piece of an asteroid. Traveling a mind-boggling 5 billion kilometers, the sample has finally returned back to Earth on December 5th, marking the second time that scientists will be able to lay hands on an asteroid sample that did not have to face re-entry without a heat shield. Here are some absolutely stunning pictures showing the return capsule above Australia shortly before landing. Perfectly preserved and unaltered, it will give us a priceless insight into Ryugu and the formation of our solar system. Welcome home, Hayabusa 2. Congratulations to JAXA for expanding our horizon and scoring an incredible goal. The second rocket carried China's Chang'e 5 lunar mission, and since our moon is much closer, it had far less travel time. It successfully touched down on December 1st, only 9 days after launch. Incredible pictures there from the lunar surface. But if you want to return something back to Earth, you have to take off again, which makes the mission much more complex. After touching down on the near side of the moon at Oceanus Procellarum, Chang'e 5 started the sample collection. The location is a large elevated volcanic mound, and what makes the region so extremely interesting is the fact that the area formed only around 1.2 billion years ago. All the samples returned over the course of the Apollo program were much older, dated at around 3.1 to 4.4 billion years. These samples will tell us more about our moon's more recent history and its volcanic activity not too long ago. And after successfully collecting the samples, the ascent stage was launched back into orbit and docked again with the orbiter. On December 6th, the return module successfully undocked from the orbiter and is now on its way back to Earth, expected to arrive on December 16th. One to go, OSIRIS-REx. Lifting off on board a ULA Atlas V rocket from Cape Canaveral, OSIRIS-REx's target was Bennu, a near-Earth asteroid similar to Hayabusa 2. The goal? Get samples of a very special asteroid that is expected to be 4.5 billion years old, telling the story of the very early beginnings of our solar system and bringing them back home for analysis. And if you noticed something strange about the rocket's exhaust, don't worry, you were correct. With an asymmetric thrust setup featuring only one booster attached to the rocket, even the launch was a very interesting sight to behold. Bennu is a so-called carbonaceous chondrite, one of the most ancient asteroids that can be found in our solar system. The big difference here to anything you could find on the surface of our planet is that it is completely unprocessed. Bennu has been as it is for the past 4.5 billion years. The material tells a story from the time when Earth was forming. On August 11th of this year, OSIRIS-REx had its biggest milestone so far. It plunged down 44 meters towards Bennu's surface and scooped up its sample. While doing so, it had a bigger appetite than anticipated, though. When OSIRIS-REx first arrived at Bennu, scientists realized that it was a very different place than what they expected. First thermal images indicated a sandy ball. It turned out to be a much different sight, though. From small to large rocks, Bennu had a much more unpredictable surface. NASA even had to redesign the onboard software to give the probe optical navigation capabilities to raise navigation and precision. NASA initially planned to collect around 60 grams of sample mass. The collector worked much better than anticipated, though, and collected closer to a kilogram. There were pieces in there that were more than a centimeter long. The capsule could not close properly, and there was concern that due to the fact that the sample particles were floating around, they could not properly enclose it in the return capsule. NASA had to redesign the whole mission setup to be able to perform the operation, and in the end they were successful. The sample is stowed and OSIRIS-REx right now is planning the return voyage. In March 2021, the return window opens and OSIRIS-REx will start its return journey back to Earth for a planned arrival on September 24th in 2023. The spacecraft itself will leave Earth after separating the return capsule. It will enter Earth's atmosphere at around 43,000 kilometers per hour and it's protected by a heat shield. After deploying a parachute, it will softly touch down in the Utah desert. Three very different missions with one similar goal: to bring back samples to Earth and give us the opportunity to do research we were never able to do before. What a time to be alive! And if you like complex questions and answers, you should try out some popcorn, your favorite beverage, and today's sponsor. CuriosityStream is smart TV for your smart TV. If you're watching my channel regularly, chances are very high that you're into science. CuriosityStream has thousands of streamable documentaries and non-fiction TV shows on topics like history, nature, science, food, technology, travel, and more. They are specialized in what we love most. Featuring 35 collections of curated programs handpicked by experts and streaming to any device for viewing anytime, anywhere. Whether you want to explore Mars or travel back to ancient civilizations, CuriosityStream adds new binge-worthy films and series each week, empowering you to dive deep into your favorite subjects and explore new territory, sure to entertain, enlighten, and inspire. Featuring award-winning exclusive and originals, CuriosityStream is one of the largest libraries of high-quality documentaries out there. To binge-watch the finest documentaries and at the same time support What About It, head over to CuriosityStream through my link or use the code What About It and sign up for just $14.99 for a whole year. Satisfy your thirst for knowledge with CuriosityStream. Link is in the description. Today's Patreon and YouTube member shoutout goes to Philippe Nail Valecki, Kevin Walker, The Bald Eagle, Yuli Zabos, Hyperion, Peter Coyle, MT Bass, Lee W. Benjamin, David Burden, Brad Latch, Francesca Samicelli, Jack Casey, and many, many others. You rock so much! The Y team is overwhelmed by all the support, the new arrivals on the Discord, and on the team. You make all this possible. If you're not a patron or a YouTube member yet, consider supporting the channel. Awesome perks like our thriving Discord server, ad-free previews of episodes, and your chance to talk to the team and me included. Today's team shoutout goes to Mito for giving the website team structure and a center of mass. We've been working on setting up a new, vastly improved website for some time now, and you'd be surprised how complex this task can be. Mito is getting the team together, focusing and defining tasks, and driving the project further and further. Thank you so much for your help. You rock. Of course, what? Starship is ready for launch.
Pull on.
What am I supposed to be doing?
SpaceX is preparing something big. That was my phone.
Easter egg! Woo!
Even though everything seems to be in a waiting position right now, the opposite. Dead laying on the heat shield. Everybody knows a heat shield. Puck vector. Looking at all the changes together, we can see that